Hey there, I'm Dr. Karr, and I'm here to help you make smarter choices to live a healthier life. Today, we're diving into the world of NAD, a molecule that's central to how our bodies produce energy and repair damage. It's been linked to aging and longevity, which is why there's so much talk about boosting NAD with IV drips, supplements, and precursors like NMN or NR. It's been linked to aging and longevity, which is why there's so much talk about boosting NAD with IV drips, supplements, and precursors like NMN or NR. But there's an important question we need to ask. Even if we can raise NAD within our cells, do we actually see real-world health benefits? That's where things get interesting. And in many ways, we just don't have the data yet. Let's explore the mechanisms, the evidence, and where we still have unanswered questions. So NAD, or nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, is at the heart of our metabolism. It helps convert what we eat into cellular energy, ATP. And it also plays a big role in activating repair enzymes like sirtuins and PARPs. So if NAD does drop as we age, it is plausible that topping it back up might help our cells function like they did when we were younger. That's the theory anyway. But a theory is only as good as the human data backing it up. So the studies show that NAD levels drop by about 50% from youth to middle or old age. Why? Because as DNA damage and inflammation wrap up with age, enzymes that consume NAD, like PARPs and CD38, go into overdrive. And for many scientists, low NAD is part of the reason older cells struggle to keep up with everyday repair tasks. That's an appealing narrative, but we should remember, aging has multiple drivers. Even if we boost NAD, is that enough to tip the scale in our favor? The jury's out. Boosting NAD could enhance mitochondrial energy output, activate sirtuins, which modulate stress responses and metabolism, and improve DNA repair via PARPs, assuming you have enough NAD to spare. But the critical question is, does this actually translate into meaningful health outcomes, like reducing disease risk or extending lifespan in humans? We see promising animal data, and we do have some small human trials showing that NMN or NR can modestly improve things like insulin sensitivity or blood pressure in certain groups. We're still missing that large-scale, long-term trial that would confirm an actual improvement in clinical endpoints, like fewer heart attacks, lower cancer rates, or extended health span. So how do we boost NAD levels? I think for this, I like the analogy of a car. It's a simple way to visualize these different approaches. So first, you have the IV NAD infusions. Think of this like trying to refill your car's gas tank with a massive, awkward funnel. Sure, some gas will get in, but a lot of it may spill on the ground. With IV NAD, your blood NAD does spike, but much of it gets metabolized before it can enter cells in a stable, long-term way. Plus, these infusions can be expensive and uncomfortable if done too quickly. Next are the oral NAD pills. This is like taking a big jug of gasoline and just pouring it on top of your car, hoping some of it makes it in the tank. Chances are most NAD gets broken down in the gut. You might end up absorbing mostly nicotinamide, a B3 vitamin, rather than intact NAD. And lastly, NR or NMN supplements. Think of NR or NMN as a standard gas pump nozzle that fits right in the car's gas tank. These precursors are smaller molecules. They're more efficiently absorbed and get converted to NAD inside the cells. In published human studies, both NR and NMN consistently raise blood and tissue NAD. The big debate, though, is how much that actually matters for your long-term health. All right, so what does the research say? Yes, we can raise NAD. Trials with NR or NMN show a clear bump in NAD levels, often between 30 and 60% within weeks. That's reproducible and seems safe in the short term. In terms of health outcome measures, here's where the data is a bit more mixed. A few small studies report modest improvements in insulin sensitivity, mild reductions in blood pressure, or better muscle improvements in older adults. But many of these studies are short, 8 to 12 weeks, and with small sample sizes. Additionally, not every study sees a clinically significant change. And lastly, the long-term unknowns. We don't have conclusive evidence that boosting NAD prevents major diseases, extends human lifespan, or meaningfully lowers mortality risk. We just haven't done those large, long-duration, randomized control trials. So while I'd say the signal is intriguing, it's hardly proof. And for me, that's the central point. Yes, we can raise intracellular NAD levels, but do we know if it definitively improves heart health outcomes? Not yet. So as with any health intervention, there's potential upsides and downsides. In terms of safety, the short-term data looks fine, with little to no serious side effects from NR or NMN at standard doses. Regarding cancer considerations, there is a theoretical concern that extra NAD may fuel fast-growing cancer cells. The flip side is better DNA repair might reduce cancer risk. We need more clarity. As far as long-term data gaps, taking these supplements for years or decades We don't know if that's beneficial, neutral, or could have hidden risks. And lastly, people paying hundreds or thousands for NAD IV drips may experience a strong placebo effect. Also, many report feeling energetic, but that can be from hydration or simply a sense of, I'm investing in my health, so I must feel better. In short, short-term safety seems fine, but the actual payoff for clinical outcomes is still unproven. If you're at high risk for cancer or dealing with serious illnesses, definitely speak with a healthcare professional before experimenting. So finally, practical takeaways and balanced recommendations. If you're wondering whether you should be boosting NAD, here's my perspective. First, we have solid mechanistic rationale, but only partial human data. We clearly see an increase in NAD from these supplements. Whether that automatically translates into better health or longevity is still unknown. Next, NR and NMN are the most efficient boosters. If you're intent on trying NAD therapy, these appear to be the best bet for actually raising intracellular NAD. Additionally, lifestyle remains the bedrock. If you're neglecting exercise, nutrition, sleep, no supplement is going to make up the difference. Some studies even indicate that fasting and exercise may naturally elevate NAD. And finally, monitor and measure. If you do experiment, especially at higher doses, work with a clinician. Track objective markers over time to see if it's doing anything meaningfully for you. In my view, NAD supplementation is a potentially useful adjunct for metabolically challenged individuals, but we're not in a place to declare it a proven strategy for extending human health span or lifespan. I follow the research closely, and I'm hoping we'll get bigger trials that clarify if these NAD gains actually move the needle on real-world health outcomes. Until then, optimism is fine, but keep it tempered with the understanding that raising NAD and improving outcomes are not always the same thing. Thanks for joining me in this deep dive. NAD is a fascinating part of our biology with real scientific intrigue, but the gap between boosting NAD and proven health benefits still exists. If you found this breakdown helpful, please hit like and subscribe for more nuanced, data-driven discussions on longevity science. Again, I'm Dr. Karr, and I'm here to help you make smarter choices to live a healthier life. Thank you.